Random House Audio presents Simon Wiesenthal by Tom Segev. Read for you by Marc Cashman. Introduction. The Glass Box. Never before had there been such a funeral. Never before had the remains of so many people been buried in one grave. The procession began in Tel Aviv on June 26, 1949. The horror enveloping the city's great synagogue was almost unbearable, and hysterical shrieks rose from people crowding around the building. The newspapers reported that there were tens of thousands present and described heartbreaking scenes. There were cries of "Mama! Papa!" and many fainted. Small children were also to be seen. In the main hall of the synagogue stood a glass box, 5 feet long. In it were 30 porcelain urns painted with blue and white stripes. According to the newspapers, they contained the ashes of 200,000 Jews who had been murdered in the Holocaust. The mayor was there, as well as other dignitaries and rabbis. Speeches were made and prayers intoned, and then the glass box was loaded onto a police vehicle to be carried through some of the city streets. The vehicle had trouble making its way through the crowds. Along the route that the box traveled, people closed their shops and workshops and lined the sidewalks, watching the procession in silent awe. The first stop on the route was Rehovot, where President Chaim Weizmann had his home. Classes were canceled in the town's schools, and the students were sent to see the box. Weizmann, aged and frail and almost blind, said a few words. Then the box was taken to Jerusalem, and at the entrance to the city, there were once again thousands, waiting and weeping. Some of them brought bars of soap. They mistakenly believed that the soap had been made out of the bodies of Jews and wanted to bury it with the glass box in the soil of the ancient cemetery of Sanhedria, among graves that had been hewn out of rock 2,000 years before. The man who organized this historic spectacle was Simon Wiesenthal, then 41 years old. From the day he was released from the Mauthausen concentration camp in Austria, he had lived in the nearby city of Linz and occupied himself with searching out Nazi war criminals. The ashes of the dead had been collected at his initiative at concentration camps and other detention sites across Austria. The glass box, he wrote later, had suddenly become a kind of looking glass in which the faces of many, many were reflected. Friends from the ghetto, companions from the concentration camps, people who had been beaten to death, died of starvation, been hounded into the electrified fence. I could see the panicked faces of Jews who were whipped and clubbed into the gas chambers, chased from behind by human animals devoid of conscience or feelings, who would not hear their lone plea to let them live. By then, Wiesenthal already knew several Israelis, but not many Israelis knew him. The mayor of Tel Aviv, Yisrael Rokach, for one, didn't know who he was when Wiesenthal first contacted him in Yiddish a few months before. But Rokach seems to have been impressed by Wiesenthal's assertive style. It was more like an order than a query, request, or suggestion. The Association of Former Concentration Camp Inmates in Austria had decided to transfer the ashes of the martyrs to Israel and to honor the city of Tel Aviv by making it the recipient, Wiesenthal wrote. There was no way to refuse, and Rokach replied that Tel Aviv would accept the urns with a tremor of sanctity, although he had no idea what to do with them. The annihilation of the Jews haunted many of the inhabitants of Israel. They were tormented by the pain. Already in 1946, ashes brought from a camp in Poland had been interred in Israel. But even in 1949, nobody really knew the right way to go about mourning 6 million dead, or how to perpetuate their memory. The law on prosecuting Nazis and their collaborators would only be enacted a year later. The official Holocaust Memorial Day would be designated 2 years later. And the law establishing the state memorial authority, Yad Vashem, would be passed only in 1953. When Wiesenthal came to Israel, the Holocaust was still wrapped in silence. Parents never told their children what they had experienced. The children never dared to ask. Holocaust survivors made people flinch with anxiety, embarrassment, and feelings of guilt. They were not easy to live with. How can you share an apartment building with them, work with them, go to the movies or the beach with them? How can you fall in love with them and marry them? How can their children go to school with yours? It's doubtful that any other society ever faced so difficult or painful an encounter with the other, to use a phrase that came into currency later. Many of the Israelis who had settled in the country before World War II or were born there tended to relate condescendingly to Holocaust victims and survivors, identifying them with the Jews of the diaspora, whom they despised as the polar opposite of the new Hebrews they were trying to create in the land of Israel, in the spirit of the Zionist vision. It was customary to blame the victims for not coming to the country beforehand, remaining in Europe instead, and waiting to be slaughtered without doing anything to prevent it. They were despised for their weakness, because most of them had not fought against the Nazis, but had gone to their deaths like lambs to the slaughter. Many Holocaust survivors found neither a sympathetic ear nor any compassion. Often, they were not even believed when they related what had happened to them. For their part, the survivors had plenty to say to the Israelis. Why, they would ask, had the Zionist movement not made greater efforts to rescue them from the Nazis? Implicit in this question was a terrible accusation, and the leaders of the movement found it difficult to explain their powerlessness. Besides the question of what they could have done, there was the far more embarrassing one of whether they had taken any interest at all in the plight of European Jews. Many survivors of the Holocaust were shocked to discover after the war that Jews in the United States and in Palestine had lived through the war in relative complacency. Reports about the destruction of their brethren concerned them only to the extent that their day-to-day lives were affected. Wiesenthal once described how, soon after the war, he had seen Jewish newspapers from America and Palestine printed in the summer of 1943, when he was a concentration camp inmate. "And what I read was terribly depressing to me," he wrote. For the papers described the routines of community life, politics, economic prosperity, culture, entertainment, and family celebrations. Only here and there did Wiesenthal find items about the murder of the Jews in Poland, based usually on BBC reports. In the papers from Palestine, he found big headlines about Arabs who attacked a kibbutz and killed two cows. A report about what was happening in Poland by a refugee who had made it to Palestine was relegated to page 7. I started asking myself, are we still one people, the same people? He wrote. In 1946, Wiesenthal attended the first Zionist Congress since the Holocaust, held in Basel, Switzerland, and the thought ran through his mind that the leaders of the Zionist movement deserved to be put on trial, like the heads of the Nazi regime who were tried in Nuremberg. I took a good look at those who were our leadership and had done very little to save Jews, he related. He was referring to Israel's first prime minister, David Ben-Gurion, among others. By bringing the ashes of the victims to Jerusalem for burial, Wiesenthal was demanding of the Israelis that they at long last confront the Holocaust, in the same way that in the days to come, he was to demand it of the other nations of the world. The institutions and the officials involved in organizing the funeral tended to look upon the matter as a nuisance, but Wiesenthal would not let them alone. At first, he had written to Yad Vashem, but at that time it was only a private society operating out of a three-room office and having a hard time paying the rent.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.